I am Andrew Ryan, and I'm here to ask you a question. Is a man not entitled to the sweat of his brow? No, says the man in Washington, it belongs to the poor. No, says the man in the Vatican, it belongs to God. No, says the man in Moscow, it belongs to everyone. I rejected those answers. Instead, I chose something different. I chose the impossible. I chose rapture. A city where the artist would not fear the censor, where the scientist would not be bound by petty morality, where the great would not be constrained by the small. And with the sweat of your brow, rapture can become your city as well. To build a city at the bottom of the sea, insanity. But where else could we be free from the clutching hand of the parasites? Where else could we build an economy that they would not try to control, a society that they would not try to destroy? It was not impossible to build rapture at the bottom of the sea. It was impossible to build it anywhere else. I believe in no God, no invisible man in the sky. But there is something more powerful than each of us, a combination of our efforts, a great chain of industry that unites us. But it is only when we struggle in our own interest that the chain pulls society in the right direction. The chain is too powerful and too mysterious for any government to guide. Any man who tells you different either has his hand in your pocket or a pistol to your neck. What is the difference between a man and a parasite? A man builds. A parasite asks, "Where is my share?" A man creates. A parasite says, "What will the neighbors think?" A man invents. A parasite says, "Watch out, or you might tread on the toes of a god." On the surface, the parasite expects the doctor to heal them for free, the farmer to feed them out of charity. How little they differ from the pervert who prowls the streets looking for a victim he can ravish for his own grotesque amusement. What is the greatest lie ever created? What is the most vicious obscenity ever perpetrated on mankind? Slavery? The Holocaust? Dictatorship? No. It's the tool with which all that wickedness is built. Altruism. Whenever anyone wants others to do their work, they call upon their altruism. Never mind your own needs, they say. Think of the needs of whoever. The state, the poor, of the army, of the king, of God. The list goes on and on. How many catastrophes were launched with the words, "Think of yourself"? It's the king and country crowd who light the torch of destruction. It is this great inversion, this ancient lie, which has chained humanity to an endless cycle of guilt and failure. My journey to rapture was my second exodus. In 1919, I fled a country that had traded in despotism for insanity. The Marxist Revolution simply traded one lie for another. Instead of one man, the Tsar, owning the work of all the people owned the work of all the people. So I came to America, where a man could own his own work, where a man could benefit from the brilliance of his own mind, the strength of his own muscles, the might of his own will. I had thought I left the Marxist altruists to their collective farms and their five-year plans. But as the German fools threw themselves on Hitler's sword for the good of the Reich, the Americans drank deeper and deeper of the Bolshevik poison, spoon-fed to them by Roosevelt and his New Dealists. And so, I asked myself, in what country was there a place for men like me? Men who refused to say yes to the parasite? parasites and the doubters, men who believed that work was sacred and property rights inviolate. And then one day, the happy answer came to me, my friends. There was no country for people like me. And that was the moment I decided to build one. On the surface, I once bought a forest. The parasites claimed that the land belonged to God and demanded that I establish a public park there. Why? So the rabble could stand slack-jawed under the canopy and pretend that it was paradise earned. When Congress moved to nationalize my forest, I burnt it to the ground. God did not plant the seeds of this Arcadia. I did. This Fontaine fellow was somebody to watch. Once he was just a menace to be convicted and hung. But he always manages to be where the evidence isn't. He's the most dangerous type of hoodlum. The kind with vision. Something must be done about Fontaine. While I was buying buildings and fish futures, he was cornering the market on genotypes and nucleotide sequences. I'm trying to build a proper financial market, and this idiot keeps going on about atom this and genetic modification that. Rapture is transforming before my eyes. The great chain is pulling away from me. Perhaps it's time to give it a tug. On my walk today, I had my first encounter with a pair of them. He, a lumbering palooka in a foul-smelling diving suit, and she, an unwashed moppet in a filthy pink smock. The pallor was off, green and morbid, and there was a rather unpleasant aspect to her demeanor, as if she were in an altogether different place than the rest of us. I understand the need for such creatures. I just wish they could make them more presentable. The children with their very long needles, their tuneless songs, their ghastly errands, their ghoulish Frankenstein fathers. But we have all placed our hand on the great chain of endeavor. My hand is on it. Fontaine's is on it. We all pull it and are pulled by it. Yes, these children are an abomination, but it is not my hand alone on the chain that created them. No, their little fingers were right there, next to mine. Dr. Suchong, frankly, I'm shocked by your proposal. If we were to modify the structure of our commercial plasmid line as you propose, to have them make the user vulnerable to mental suggestion through pheromones, would we not be able to effectively control the actions of the citizens of Rapture? Free will is the cornerstone of this city. The thought of sacrificing it is abhorrent. However, we are indeed in a time of war. If Atlas and his bandits have their way, will they not turn us into slaves? And what will become of free will then? Desperate times call for desperate measures. Is there blood in the streets? Of course. Have some chosen to destroy themselves with careless splicing? Undeniable. But I will make no proclamations. I will dictate no laws. The great chain moves slowly, but with wisdom. It is our impatience that invites in the parasite of big government. And once you've invited it in, it will never stop feeding on the body of the city. Could I have made mistakes? One does not build cities if one is guided by doubt. But can one govern in absolute certainty? I know that my beliefs have elevated me, just as I know that the things I have rejected would have destroyed me. But the city, it is collapsing before my... Have I become so convinced by my own beliefs that I have stopped seeing the truth. Perhaps. But Atlas is out there, and he aims to destroy me and to destroy my city. The question is to surrender. I will not surrender. Good evening, my friends. I hope you are enjoying your New Year's Eve celebration. It has been a year of trials for us all. Tonight, I wish to remind each of you that Rapture is your city. It was your strength of will that brought you here, and with that strength, you shall rebuild. And so, Andrew Ryan offers you a toast to Rapture 1959. May it be our finest year. We all make choices, but in the end, our choices make us. I came to this place to build the impossible. You came to rob what you could never build. A Hun gaping at the gates of Rome. Even the air you breathe is sponged from my account. Well, breathe deep, so later you might remember the taste. You ooze in like an assassin, and then you try to sneak out like a thief. You're no CIA spook. Who are you? Why have you come here? There's two ways to deal with a mystery. Uncover it, or eliminate it. Before the final rat has eaten the last gram of you, Rapture will have returned. I will lead a parade. Who is that? They'll say, as they point to the sad shape hanging on my wall. Who was that? Even in a book of lies, sometimes you find truth. There is indeed a season for all things, and now that I see you flesh to flesh and blood to blood, I know I cannot raise my hand against you. But know this, you are my greatest disappointment. Does your master hear me? Atlas, you can kill me, but you will never have my city. My strength is not in steel and fire. That is what the parasites will never understand. A season for all things. A time to live, and a time to die. A time to build, and a time to destroy. The assassin has overcome my final line of defense, and now he plans to murder me. In the end, what separates a man from a slave? Money? Power? No. A man chooses, and a slave obeys. You think you have memories? A farm? A family, an airplane, a crash, and then this place. Was there really a family? Did that airplane crash, or was it hijacked? Forced down by something less than a man, something bred to sleepwalk through life unless activated by a simple phrase, spoken by their kindly master. Come in. Stop. Would you kindly? Powerful phrase. Familiar phrase. Sit. Would you kindly? Stand. Would you kindly? Run. Stop. Turn. Was a man sent to kill? Or a slave? Now sleep. A man chooses. A slave opens.